Okay, now we consider it, because as I already mentioned, there are a lot of generalized models. So we consider it one of, let's say, old micropolar or Asara continuum. So outline is given here, and some remarks related to Cassara idea, Cassara type idea. It was, as usual, formulated. Some people introduced not only translational interaction between particles, but some additional models related to rotations and so on. It was done quite a long time ago. And it was written book by brothers Cassara, who introduced in this book new model of continuum. Book was published more than 100 years ago, and so on. And some of these ideas were, by the way, were published even before. And then it was almost forgotten. Then Erikson and Ruzel, they rediscovered the idea, start to do something. And after that, it was in 60s, it was so-called Renaissance of Cassara continuum. And there are a lot of people published, let's say, basic equations about such kind of generalized media from Russia, Germany, and also Italy. It was Grioli who published this paper about so-called asymmetric elasticity. And it was introduced that time few CISM courses, because people trying to understand and teach others what is it, this model. And what I would like to say for that moment, Stoyanovich, this is, by the way, could be found freely in internet, and Stoyanovich published some reviews about mechanics of polar and micropolar continuum, including a lot of references. So up to these years, it was almost, let's say, all collections related to reference at time. Then it was some kind of situation when this theory not so well treated by people, because probably the theory did not found proper applications. Nevertheless, after that, it was some kind of so-called, recently we have some renaissance of generalized continuum, and basics of this model is presented in some kind of books, proceedings, and so on. The basic idea behind of such materials, such generalized model, is to describe some seriously in homogeneous material slides. For example, here you see polymer open cell foam. This is just a bit magnified picture of foam which we use in kitchen. It used in kitchen before became scientific object here in this presentation. And this is complex, so-called complex medium. And what's the idea of macropolar continuum? The idea is, looks like we have in mind that particles, let's say some small parts of this continuum, could be represented not only via only translations, but also via rotations. Because here it's clear why, because this form made of, let's say, some beams. In the case of closed form, closed cell form, by, let's say, shells. And of course, as we already saw, in this case, we have some moments, and so model should inherit some cow microstructure of this. Okay, some notations I will skip, and then we will try to repeat the basic idea which we already used in the case of linear elasticity, but modified for this model. So we start from dynamics. So we introduce classical, let's say, mass point motion. In this case, everything is nice. It's the best brilliant mathematical theory, which is quite simple. You have, if you have a system of particles of masses mi, there is Newton's laws for this and so on. Okay, we introduce momentum and moment of momentum by this definition. It's just standard definition. And here is already participated our famous cross product. So, okay. So, and formulation of the motion equation for this case is quite easy. So we formulated it that total force vector results in equilibrium it was zero, and total moment was zero. Here we have some inertia terms. And inertia terms it could be derived from this momentum or moment of momentum. And this, by the way, some of these equations were known even before Newton and so on. Okay, now we switch to more complex object, so-called rigid body. In the rigid body, we will describe as following. We consider it the motion of, or change in position, if you want, of rigid body. A rigid body is collection of the mass points such that distances between these points are fixed, so it could only translate it and rotate it. Okay, for description of translation, it's quite easy what we can do. We can introduce take some point inside of this rigid body and see how this point is moving in space. Okay, for sure, rigid body differs from mass point just because it has size and should rotate. And to describe rotation, we introduce such a stuff. We rigidly attach to the first body in initial state three vectors, orthogonal vectors called directors. So it looks like something we have different, okay. Let us assume that they are orthogonal, something like that. And this triple deformed together with a solid because it's attached rigidly. So if we consider it two positions of our rigid body, we see the first position is determined by one vector, and then this triple of directors. And for sure, directors could be chosen unit vectors. In current state, we can introduce also the position vector and triple of these vectors. Okay, so for sure we know how to determine, for example, the position of chosen point. We will call it pole. And other, let's say, positions of any other points looks like, if we consider the points Z now describe any point, arbitrary point of our rigid body, we can do the following. We introduce the position of this vector, of this point could be determined by position of the pole plus additional vector. And after translation and rotation, we have similar configuration. Everything is just description is quite easy. So the position of any point is described by this formula. So we have initial position plus translations plus rotations of initial, let's say, additional vector z vector. And okay, and here we introduce rotation tensor. It's proper orthogonal tensor when these directors are chosen right-hand oriented or left-hand oriented. If you're using a different choice, it will be non-properly orthogonal, but here we assume that it's proper orthogonal, just a rotation tensor. Okay, then we do the following stuff. Because for these quantities, momentum and moment of momentum, we need velocities. We just let us calculate velocity. What I should do? I differentiate this equation with respect to time. So I get the velocity of my point, arbitrary point, as a sum of velocity of pole plus this guy. Derivative of orthogonal tensor results in skew symmetric tensor. So dot Q dot by Q transpose results in skew symmetric tensor as any skew symmetric tensor could be represented like this. Okay, and this omega, it's a conjugate vector because skew symmetric tensor has three independent parameters, three independent components. It could be treated as a vector. And this vector is omega. In this case, we denote it by omega. And this is nothing else as an angular velocity. So you are welcome. You meet angular velocity. So we have linear velocity and angular velocity. Okay. And from this equation, it could be found using this Gibbsian cross product. So it's vectorial invariant introduced 100 years ago. 100 years ago, more than 100 years ago. So, okay, so we have formula which is known from rigid body dynamics, like look introduced in different ways. Okay, and what we are doing? We, for a solid body, our rigid body, instead of sum, we replace our sums because here it was a sum of, where is it? It were sums with respect to mass points. We replace these sums by integrals because now the masses is continuously distributed. We introduce density, mass density. Of course, if you need some concentrated masses, you should say that, okay, this rho is mass density replaced by continuous function plus some delta functions. Of course, if you are brave enough, you can introduce even more, but it will result in even more complex cases. Okay, so this is just direct translation from a mass point motion to rigid body motion. Okay, then as we choose our point O, O as an arbitrary point, it means we can choose it as we wish. And for simplicity, I will choose it body mass center. So it could be geometrical center if the body is homogeneous, but mass according to mass. In the case of dynamics, it's very good choice to consider it all as a center of mass. Okay, in this case, we have just definition what is R zero for center of mass. This looks like that. In this case, we have some simplifications of our momentum and moment of momentum. And they became, this is just nothing, it's quite understandable. We have mass by velocity of the pole. But here, from a moment of momentum, we should have this to consider this guy, and this brings us to the tensor, so-called tensor of inertia. So if we see the first time the inertia tensor, which is formulated like here, it's by definition, and here we should integrate over our solid body. And this results that it is second order tensor. Moreover, we will see that this second order tensor has some kind of invariant properties, which we already discussed. So this J is rotated with respect to rotation of our solid. So here we have introduced initial inertial tensor. And we see that as a result, we have that initial inertial tensor is given. It's canonical, could be treated as canonical one, it could be calculated for ellipsoid, for sphere, and so on, so on. And then it rotated. Unfortunately, it means for us that J depends on time. It does not depend on time in very simple cases, like, let's say, homogeneous ball or homogeneous sphere. In this case, it's constant, because in this case, he's just a ball tensor. It depends for like this. And now I is unit tensor. Okay. It's a definition. It's just for definition, because in this case I would like to be precise that, for example, this is the equation and this is the definition. It defined as this. Okay, and of course this tensor is symmetric. It's obvious that it's symmetric. As it's symmetric, it could be represented in principal axis. And this is so principal moments of inertia. And moreover, as we have this equation, and if you differentiate this equation with respect to time and take into account how q dot is, we came to a nice equation which looks like that. This is evolution equation for inertial tensor. So on the other hand, we can say that, okay, inertial tensor is a solution of this equation for a given angular velocity and given initial data. So you can also calculate this. So, okay, and then we can introduce two Euler motion blurs, which looks the same like for mass points. This is, by the way, could be treated as some kind of axioms. Okay, mass point, it's the last equation could be derived, but here in general not. Okay, so in any case, in statics we have what we had before: total force, net force is zero, total torque or total moment is zero, and that it is probably was known for Archimedes' time. The last, especially Lever law, was known that time. Okay. And formally, this cannot be derived from Newton laws, because straightforwardly we should introduce some additional assumptions of the nature of interaction between particles, and it is an interesting story, because for example Lagrange spent a lot of time trying to prove the second statement from the first one. And this is, by the way, not so easy. But now we switch to micropolar bodies. And we have continuum, so it means that it's deformable, and now we consider it what we have as our kinematical descriptors. Our kinematical descriptors, now we have two kinematical descriptors. The first descriptor is a position vector, and so you have some mapping one position vector into another one, and then we also have these directors, which somehow moved in space together with our, let's say, body. Now it's deformable. And of course, on the base of these directors, we introduce a rotation tensor, which transform old directors into new directors. It's a rotation tensor. In this case, it could be introduced in this way. Okay, no problem. Here we have this. So this is our kinematical parameters. Velocities, okay, nothing else, we introduce linear velocity in trivial way, less in trivial way we introduce angular velocity, in this case also following Ehringen, we can say that so-called micro gyration vector. And this is but from the point of view, you can treat your continuum now as following. This continuum consists of, small, infinitesimally small material particles, and these particles interact to each other by forces and moments. Or if you have in mind some, discrete structure based, for example, on, balls, rigid balls connected to each other by springs and rotational springs. So we have some kind of independent properties. Okay, we have these guys here. This guy cross is defined like this, cross product. It just replaces our tensor product by cross product. It's operation, symbolic operation. We deleted circle. And from diet we get vector. It is just annotations like a language. So we introduce forces, and now we introduce forces in couples as a primary quantities. So we have forces, we have couples. Couples are denoted by this squared circled arrows. And then what we are doing? We can repeat. You already saw how everything means stress tensor was introduced in linear elasticity or in general elasticity, because at that moment it wasn't any assumption of the smallness. So stress tensor was introduced for any deformations. And now we repeat how it was introduced for micropolar continuum. So again, we introduce body forces and body couples and contact forces and contact couples. And this is typical assumption, just also introduce stress vector and couple stress vector. And from the point of view of modeling, this is rather strong assumption, because it somehow results in some locality. Okay, then we also introduce a moment of momentum, which is just we mimic everything from the rigid body dynamics, nothing else. What is difference? That here, for example, instead of moment of inertia, I said, let us be scalar. Let our particles has only, let's say, spherical shape. Of course, it's contradict to symmetry configuration, but that's okay. For simplicity, we say that, okay, that we have rotationary inertia, isotropic case. Just for simplicity, I can put here J and have, let's say, more complex expressions, but finally, it's not a big deal to do this. And we again formulate the same balance equations. We just say, okay, now instead of rigid body, have deformable body. Our deformable body is okay. We use this principle of solidification. So it means that equilibrium or motion conditions should be fulfilled for any part. So we consider any part P of our body, we surround it with the boundary and so on, and apply to this. And then we just say, let's say, the same stuff. So we are doing similarly to elasticity case. We introduce that our vectors depends on the position at normal. Okay, in this case it will be interesting question, what happens if it depends, for example, on the curvature. We will obtain some strain gradient micropolar elasticity, which is nice, but it's already complex structure. But okay, we introduce this. Just doubled our vector is doubled. Then we consider it Cauchy lemma, that we can prove it, that they have this property, we can prove it. Okay, let me skip this proof because it's quite obvious. We just, what is new here with respect to the case which we considered before is just, it's just inertia terms, but it's not big problem to take it in account because they looks like mass forces. So formally I can unify these two integrals in one integral, introduce some notations for the sum and repeat just the same consideration. So I do it. The idea is, I remind you, we consider it this balance equation for the whole part, then we consider the balance equations for parts. Two parts, we cut it and consider balance equation for two parts. And then we subtract from the first equation other equations and see what is happens on this cut. What is happens in this cut? And from this equation on the cut, we've got this kind of equation. Then we repeat that because this cut gamma is arbitrary, So integrands must be this equal to zero, and so on. We've got our Cauchy lemma. And the same idea belongs to moments, but in the case of moments, it's a bit more tricky because here in this equation, when you see this is, let's say, linear velocity acceleration, and for moment of momentum, you have the moment of this surface traction. So this is brings us some additional difficulties, but technical difficulties, because for T we already knew everything. And for mu, we don't know any for the moment anything, but nevertheless, we do it a similar way, and that says that they have necessary property. Okay, and Cauchy theorem, which we formulate for elasticity in this way, is extended just by couple stress tensors. So we introduce two second order tensors, T and M, called Cauchy stress and Cauchy couple stress tensors. Okay, congratulations, we have it. So before of this, let me note, before of couples, we introduce this, and from second equation, we got that T, capital T, must be symmetric. Here, nothing like this, because instead, from the second balance of moment of momentum, we get another tensor, and we will get non-trivial equation of motion, and so on, so on, so on. Okay. And to prove it, this theorem, we do the same technique because nothing else. We consider it's a parallelepiped, and we apply to this for T. I will skip it because, as I mentioned, what is new here is just inertia terms, but we can unify it with the mass forces, and then we got this equation in component form. And then we introduce tetrahedron T, apply for this declined phase everything, and do it. And finally, we got that this guy is a linear function of normal. So it's every linear function over there is a linear second order tensor. It's just from representation, so we have Cauchy stress tensor. Super. Then what we have else, we should do is the same from couple stress tensor. Okay, and this is just, you have the meshing, you have two, and you put, instead of T, you put mu, and get the same results. Almost everything looks like that. So here, let's say, what is complication that we have in integrals of this guy, but we already manage this considering our previous case of standard elasticity. We already manage this. So I'm doing this, I replace T by our stress tensor. Then what I should do, I should somehow move this derivative out of these brackets just to act on this. And then we came to this differential equation, which looks like that. Before, this nothing of this wasn't. Before, in elasticity, we get only the last term, from which we got that TSK should be symmetric matrix. Here, instead, we have additional a lot of stuff. And of course, T cannot be symmetric in general. So this is again, I repeat that what is it. And then we transform everything into form, such a form that we try to kick out this linear velocity and other guys, because we already have the first equation of motion. So we have some manipulation is divergence. We prove that this is should be Z and so on. And finally, we transform our equation in this form. And then we moved it. Finally, we came to that vector mu is linearly dependent on n, and so there is a moment stress tensor. Okay, so idea the proof for moments is a bit tricky because we should somehow take into account the previous equation and manipulate in such a way that shows that everything related to t must be zero. So we did it. And so it's okay, there are definitions, they count a Schick type and stress tensors and coupled stress tensors. They're not symmetric. Okay. And this is not so nice. Not so nice because they're not symmetric. So we have 9 components for each tensor, so it is not so okay. A few words about in classical mechanics of elasticity, we introduce positive and negative stresses, like here. This is a definition for positive stresses.
So that here we have changed the convention. So the first index.
Yes, the first index relates, the last index relates to the normal. So it's just demonstration that I can write, not, I cannot write by left hand and right hand independently, but I can change convention easily from, let's say, American, let's say some kind of American style to, let's say, Italian style, and back and forth. And sometimes it's a result just in the final equation in appearance of sine plus and minus. It's okay. But here it's, by the way, it's important because they are non-symmetric. And this is negative stresses. Okay, and for coupled stresses, it's more tricky. Because coupled stresses, usually if you use these notations with a circular arrows, it looks like that. Okay, this is a positive stresses, and you can formulate it also with big chain words. What is it? Because here you have drilling moment and 2 bending moments. This guy is called drilling moment because it's exactly what we have when we have torsion. Another
just the last image should be N23.
Yes. Okay. Nobody is perfect, and this picture is also not so perfect. Okay, so again here. So instead of these awkward notations with arrows, we can distinguish vectors, we will write moments with doubled arrow. Is doubled arrows, so okay, this is a vectors. And sign rule for coupled stresses could be written as here, it's quite lengthy, but it's just mimics the sign rule for stresses, and I will, don't want to read it to boring you, and just to show the picture what the positive and what the negative. Okay? Okay. No protests from the public, so it's okay. And now let me say that what is happens with the principal stresses here. And principal stresses was introduced for elasticity as a eigenvalues of stress tensor. And here it's not so nice idea because in general it's not symmetric tensor and eigenvalues is not could be imaginary. So, and what we can do if we try to find some kind of simplest representation of stress tensors here. Here we can use some kind of from algebra that for symmetric tensor we have spectral decomposition of this kind, but this requires symmetry of the tensor T. Not let's say all the time, but simplest requirement is symmetry results in this. Okay, but for non-symmetric cases, we can say that we only can introduce some kind of singular value decomposition of such a kind. T could be written as a diagonal tensor because it looks like diagonal, but in two different bases. So you have one basis, second basis, and these two bases, you have diagonal numbers. Okay, but having two bases is not a good idea. If we restrict ourselves by one basis, what happens? And then it could be the proper answer that it's so-called what the simplest form of T, non-symmetric T, is so-called real Jordan canonical form. And this is which we have. And unfortunately, there are some possibilities. So matrix could be transformed into diagonal form and to, let's say, diagonal, but it depends on multiplicity of eigenvalues. So if they're different, it's okay. But if two of them coincides to each other, the case becomes twofold. Could be diagonal or not diagonal with some kind of this epsilon, some additional parameter. And the case of multiplicity of, for example, hydrostatic case, when the everything is all eigenvalues are real and the same, we can three possibilities. And finally, because here eigenvalues could be even complex and conjugate complex, we have such kind of representation. And when we have these cases, let's say second line and third line, this epsilon means usually this transformation into a diagonal form could be treated like that. I consider it the solid body. I can take a cube in this solid body in such a way that rotating this cube, I find the position of this cube, that in this cube, on the faces of this cube, acts only normal stresses. Here we cannot find such a cube, but we can kind of find some kind of prism. When epsilon goes to zero, the faces of this prism goes to be coincided, so it degenerated. But nevertheless, it's somehow related. Okay, but in this form, you can formulate SM. So we came to equation of motion, and this equation of motion have the same form as if you restrict the first equation, it will be equation of motion, which you already saw. And here we have additional, let's say, equation. For classic elasticity, we have only this T cross equal to zero, which means that T cross is symmetric, and that's it. That's very nice. Nothing else. But here, unfortunately, it is non-trivial equation having the same nature, second order partial differential equation similar to first one and so on. So it could be written in this form like let's say in Cartesian components. Let me know that if we put instead of this scalar J tensor of J, J also should be differentiated, and this inertia became nonlinear and brings, by the way, a lot of troubles to analytical solution, because in rigid body dynamics there are only few cases when you can solve equation of motion analytically. And belongs to such people like Euler, Lagrange, and Sofia Kovalevskaya. And last case is rather tricky. Okay, what we can do from this? This is an equation formulated because our forces and curves are defined in actual configuration and current placement, in another word. This everything is written in Eulerian formulation. It means that everything is written here in form of Eulerian coordinates. Now x small x is Eulerian coordinates. Everything is written it's Eulerian coordinates in general unknown current placement. Okay. We want to switch it to Lagrangian description. And what we should do, we should change the variables and transform this equation into Lagrangian coordinates. So now, if before we had div be small, it will be related to actual configuration, and div capital relates to reference configuration. This is assumption, notation about notation. Small differential operators relate to actual, with capital related to initial. Just to distinguish that there are different differential operators. Okay, people, we have to very interesting topic because now we have for finite deformation, we should distinguish our differential operators. So the number of differential operators doubled. So you get metric coefficients for one configuration, for the second configuration, you have Christoffel symbols, different Christoffel symbols, and so on, so on. You have two curvatures, so on. For when we consider it, kinematics of linear elasticity, we assume that okay, displacement is small, so all there is no difference between two states, and we can consider the same differential operators here. Okay, we have this. Okay, and here we have instead of previous Cauchy stress and Cauchy couple stress tensors, we have what?
Sorry, may I ask a small question?
Referential tensors and nominal tensors, stress and couple stress. So we have a lot of stress tensors.
May I ask a small question?
So the Tn is an S. Are the first and the second
geometry of the stress tensor, but the generalization of it? It's a very good question. Even in nonlinear elasticity, we can introduce Piola-Kirchhoff stress tensor and so-called nominal stress tensor, and they are different. And this is exactly counterpart of the nominal stress tensors and not Piola-Kirchhoff stress tensors. So in nonlinear elasticity, you can do with your tensor the following thing. You can formulate it for actual configuration, it could be Cauchy stress tensor. And to shift it to Lagrangian description, you can introduce first Piola-Kirchhoff. Oh, okay, we are in Italy. Piola stress tensor. And it's non-symmetric, which is not so nice. Instead, we can introduce second order Piola stress tensor, which could be symmetric. Okay, and the relations between them looks like that. You see, there is a just somehow related. They're related by our rotations. And okay, there are that some dependencies between stress tensors. So a lot of stress tensors could be introduced and so, okay. And by the way, it's clear why. For example, let me say one simple example. When we consider elongation of the bar, our stress is a constant. If elongation is small, stress is defined, okay, in general, stress is defined like that, force by area of cross-section. Okay, force is clear, what is it? It's force applied, but area changing during deformation. And now I have a question, what I should do with area? I can divide force by initial area. It's quite simple because I measure it. In this case, it will be nominal stress tensor, not nominal stress. But I also can divide by area in deformed state. I measured it and divide by this. It will be true stress. The last one, it's in this case, is Cauchy stress, when the previous one is nominal stress or Piola stress, because in one-dimensional case there is no difference, no tensors, they just two properties. You have nominal stress divided by initial area, and you have, let's say, current stress divided by actual area. Forces are the same, but and for let's say large deformation, when this changes of area is important, it could result in different, let's say, diagram stress strain. So it's always interesting to ask people when the engineers or some people represent these curves, what is it exactly? What is stress? Which stress is here and what is strain is here? Because for strain, by the way, also remember that possible to divide by the of initial length of the bar or bar, let's say, final length of the bar, let's say stretching, and so it gives interesting. And in the case of three-dimensional solids, unfortunately, in addition to area, this area could be also considered as rotated, not rotated with respect to deformation. So I can treat it, for example, like initial area with initial orientation. Initial area is rotated accordingly to the deformation. Actual area, but rotated accordingly to previous state, and initial actual area rotated as it should be. In last case, we have Cauchy stress tensor, and previous cases, we have what we have different stress tensors. Okay, it's for that so-called Cauchy continuum, we should just forget about moments, inertia, because here, by the way, you have, okay, we should forget about couples, moments, rotary inertia. So you should, J should be zero, M should be zero, small m should be zero. If you forget to kill some of this stuff, you will get not Cauchy continuum with non-symmetric stress tensor. And such model exists, for example, for granular materials and so on, when tensor is general non-symmetric, and non-symmetry depends on the dynamic properties of this stuff, or you applied couples to this. But okay, if you do it, we came to symmetric tensor and so on. Now we discuss constitutive equations. Okay, we have T, M, okay, come on, we have 18 unknown components which should determine what is it. We have everything, local action principle, principle determinism, axiom of objectivity, and so on, so on. This is what we consider it. Stress tensor for sure should be objective, as it is standard tensor, nothing else. But moment tensor, couple stress tensor, is pseudo tensor, and it should be determinant of this rotation or guy, because moment used cross product in definition. Cross product result in something called pseudo vector. Okay, and we are going to process which I like, two strains. And here, okay, we came to very interesting topic, which appears like this. We wrote a paper about something else together with my colleague, Professor Petrashkevich, outstanding Polish scientist from my point of view, but okay. We're writing the paper as in proper style when two person writing a paper, he wrote his part, I'm writing my part, and then we bring the results and see the contradiction. We obtain different formulas. Then it's starting saying, who is mistaken? Nobody accepts that he is mistaken. As a result, we try to find that it. And I told that, okay, obviously this is a strain measure. And he told that obviously that that is strain measure. And they were different. Then starting saying, okay, why it is different? What is it different? And typically, like people doing it this way, especially, I cannot blame Petrashkevich that he is lazy, but I am lazy. I take a book, he said, okay, look, this is a book, this formula from that book, it's written that he is that. He said, okay, but this is another book and this is written that. What, which book is true? Okay, and we start do it and we came to this interesting results, how we can introduce strain measure, because here it's quite tricky. It's not obvious how to do. Okay, and we find that it could be introduced in different ways, And let us speak about this. Okay, I skip this. First, just a geometrical approach. What we did before, we considered lengths of some, let's say, elementary segment, elementary, let's say, fiber in initial stand, and see what is happens with this length after deformation. We called this first ds capital, second ds small, and see the difference. Let us do this in this way. But here we have a rotation, so we cannot simply say the dr minus this, because they rotated independently on this. So it could be considered just a norm of these people, these guys, norm of Z. Because they are rotated. And to see this, let's say, you should bring one of this tangent vector to another one, and as you should rotate it. Okay. And so we came to the first relative stretch tensor. We just see that what is the difference. It's okay. And okay, in this case, we see that there are a lot of possibilities to do it, because you can measure that one, the another one, and so on. And then we see what is directors. Is and what is the directors? Directors is, if I switch to Polish, tell me, because I already used some Polish words.
Sorry, what is the field reason? Is a director rigid?
Or yes, directors are rigid.
But they can move.
Rigid. But they can rigidly rotate it. They keep orthogonality, they has the same lengths, yeah, but they rotated. And now we came to interesting question, how we should distinguish two rotational tensors. Just taking norm, it's not the case. Because this means that we should to measure rotations, not a distance, but rotations. And for small cases, for small deformations, it looks like it looks like simple problem, because you can measure angles. You have two vectors, and when they small, if you have small rotations, you introduce small angle, everything is linear, you introduce angle. But if you consider it finite rotations, it's not so easy, because and the basic idea behind all this, let us consider what is happens. We consider differentials, like here we consider differentials of our directors. Unfortunately, differential of unit vector is produce something like skew-symmetric tensor, because vector is unit, so. Okay, if you consider differential of directors, we find some kind of formulas which just described something which quite similar to curvature tensors, which we introduced for the surface, but now they are defined in the space. And from the geometrical point of view, this B and C, which introduced here like derivatives, looks like some combination of differential connections, Christoffel symbols, defined in space. Okay, it's very nice to know that it's somehow related to Christoffel symbols, but okay, let us take into memory that it's somehow related. Instead, we consider it this some kind of differences between this differential, and we construct gamma. Gamma, and gamma, by the way, we take in gamma because gamma is a will be pseudo tensor, and gamma, like this green gamma, is our so-called relative Rinus tensor. Rinus is proposed by Erlangen. You can say that this tensor of bending and rotation, bending torsion tensor, or what you want. And this quite similar to, in certain senses, quite similar to bending strain measure, which we see in shells. Physical meaning is the same. In shells we have stretching, and we have bending and torsion. Here we have exactly this, we have torsion and bending, but in three-dimensional space. If you cannot imagine three-dimensional space, what is the bending of three-dimensional space, you can imagine such case. Let us you assume that in your three-dimensional space you have three, for example, such kind of beams. Okay, you see beams, and you consider bending of each beams and so on. And so torsion of the beams, and you see, let's say this is a torsion, it will be bending and so on. It looks, and this gamma is devoted to deformation of these orthogonal beams to have torsion, bending, and so on. Because it's also non-symmetric, it has nine components. Okay, it's not proper explanation probably, but some kind of idea. For each beam I have bending in two directions, okay? I have torsion, 3, 3, 3, 9 of measures, and here, okay. Okay, so we introduce this, and this relative Lagrangian measures is nice because they defined for any deformation, say, and we can check that they in undeformed state they are zero. They vanish when we consider rigid body motion for this, and unfortunately they are non-symmetric. Another way relates to Reissner, and Reissner did the following thing. He considered, let's say, equilibrium equations like this. Then he did introduce a principle of virtual work. And principle of virtual work could be introduced like this. We have F of differential equation. I multiply each of them by independent function, some function. Then I integrate by parts. And I get this expression now. And this is principle of virtual work. Then I can say, okay, come on. This is a principle of virtual work. This is the most clear what is it. It looks like a work of external actions, external forces, external causes. This is a work of internal stresses, norm stresses and couples. Okay, but if there is an energy, strain energy behind of this, it should look like stress by strain dot or variation of strain. Okay? Energy, because generally it should be variation of strain energy here instead. So these guys, which I have, should represent somehow derivative or variation of strains. I have two strains, so that looks like that. And so I can see that let them be variations of my strains. So from this, it looks like that I know the derivative of my strain. I try to find strain. And if I do this, I will find that it should be exactly a variation of my previous strain measures. And so I can say that, look, that previously found strains energetically conjugated with my strain stress tensors, because they constitute a couple. Stress strain, for each strain you have stress, for that strain you have for this stress you have strain. And this is, let's say, works. This works, so this is our, let's say, work. So it could be introduced as work conjugate strain measures. And this is a rather tricky way to introduce strain measures belonging to Reissner. And last case, which I like, because from geometrical point of view, you can introduce a lot of different cases, how to measure lengths, rotations, and so on. Here, unfortunately, there is an infinite family of such kind of geometrical measures. You can take this, that, and so on. Here it's quite natural. We have strain energy. It looks like that. Okay, what we have here? We have our strain energy depends on position vector, its gradient Q, and some additional parametric tensors like capital R, its position in reference placement, B is the microcurvature of whatever this means of reference placement, because if you consider it our example with three beams embedded in solids, so these beams could be initially curved. I haven't curved pens, but they can be curved, and this B should describe this initial curvature and initial twisting of this guys. Okay, so this is just parameters. Okay, so I use this equipresence principle. I introduce this everything. And then said, okay, let us do it like that. We assume the general dependence. Position vector, gradient, rotation, gradient, and so on. And I restrict first by first gradients, just for simplicity. Then I consider what happens if I do a so-called procedure, consider superimposed rigid body deformation. According to our principles, energy should be independent on this. So I consider it such, let's say, such transformation. Put this transformation into this formula and see what happens. Okay, new deformation gradients transform like this. R should be transformed just plus A, just shifted, and Q should be also transformed like F. We can easily check it. So from, let's say, to satisfy invariance, we see that invariance is that one. So energy, previous energy should be the same as that energy. Okay. First, we can kill R here because it's not possible that it depends on R shifted. If function is looks like F on X is equal F on X plus A for every A, it means it does not depend on X. And this is clear. I can differentiate this function, for example, with respect to R. Okay, I will differentiate it with respect to A, okay, here. And it means that I this derivative from Z side will be zero. From Z side, it will be derivative of W with respect to R. That, that result that the derivative of my energy is equal to zero. Because here, no any R, derivative is zero. Here, it will be derivative with respect to R, this guy. Okay. Then for other things, I will get that dependence of such a kind. And then I replace our orthogonal tensor O by Q transposed, and I get like formulas which looks like that. And this is third order tensor. And to be honest, for the moment, I could say that I don't like third order tensor as a strain measures, because here participated Q, Q is orthogonal gradient of Q, and it somehow it looks like Levi-Civita symbol because it's third order, but when I consider a derivative of Q by Q transposed, it results in Q symmetric tensor, which could be represented via vector. Here we have gradient, which is, by the way, vector itself, so we have combine into the form like that. It will be unit tensor cross our previously introduced bending strain measure, Wrener's tensor. So I can say, okay, come on. Instead of this guy, I will simply use gamma. Because this is a unit tensor, okay. And then I came to the same. So we have some kind of natural strain measures. And if you see in the literature, can introduce, you can find a lot of strain measures. They are mostly the same, and difference is just you see some transponations, transposition. So this, for example, that it just transposed. It was a reason why we, let's say, Stanovich instead used this symmetric strain measure, which results in symmetry of stress tensor. And this, let's say, and so Besdo, this professor, introduced another, let's say, quite unusual. He said that, okay, as it will be Q minus I and so on. And okay, there are some kind of. Finally, the last case was also outside of this Q because it was some kind of rotational vector. It was a gradient of rotational vector. Period. I introduced rotation vector and I take the derivative of this. Okay, and look, it's not the end. You see others, for example, this. Italian people from, I forget. Yes, probably from Milano. They introduced just a difference. This between that. So for sure, this is a somehow dependent. Everything is dependent because if I multiply this by Q transpose, I get this result. Okay. And let me remind that we can, instead of Q, we can introduce vectorial parametrization. This is a Gibbs formula. We have E is a vector of rotation about which we have rotation, and phi is the angle of rotation. Of course, here we assume that phi and E could be also point dependent, depend on time, and so on, so on. And in this case, you can strain measuring could be formulated in this case. I don't want to say that this is useless formulas, but you see they're a bit complicated for using for straightforward calculations. So in general, it's such kind of displacement and rotational vectorial parametrizations sometimes not gives a lot of simplifications. And here, just okay, at least here it's more visible that you see different definitions of rotational tensor which we have in different formulations of tau strain measures. So it could be useful for example, for numerics and so on. So we have some kind of information. And now I switch to another topic. If you have questions, proper time to ask me something.
Nothing that I am not completely interested in the sense that somewhere you define something depending on some epsilon.
Well, define it on what?
On epsilon.
Epsilon.
This epsilon is considered to be supposed to be.
This is a Levi-Civita tensor.
Okay.
This is a Levi-Civita tensor. Which is this Levi-Civita symbols of that?
Some of these formulas are.
Yes, sure. Nevertheless, what was surprising? Because okay, if we consider linear elasticity, strain tensor is defined uniquely. You have strain tensor. Nobody introduced something else. Okay. Even in the case of nonlinear elasticity, you can introduce different strain tensors, but they are almost, let's say, related to Cauchy-Lagrange strain tensor and so on. You can consider it itself or a logarithm of them on in power and something like that. And here you see because they are non-symmetric, you can transpose it. And of course, transpose is also looks like good. Why not to use transpose strain measure? And also because you can combine it with different, let's say, ingredients. If we see that the first column for stretch tensor, they're almost the same. Just let's say transposition minus unit tensor without minus of unit tensor and so on. For Wrinus tensor, there are, let's say, different possibility, plus, minus, transpose, no transpose, and so on. Difference, multiplication by gradient, and so on. So people, there are more, let's say, possibilities. Of course, all of them coincide to each other in the case of small deformations. Because in this case, you have only difference like transposed, non-transposed. So you have only two versions. And it also happens that in linear case, for example, Erlangen introduce in one strain measure gradient of displacement, in second gradient of rotations, but transposed.
So the difference is not visible in these two columns, because raising for instance, it's at the end. Mm-hmm. And the same first column and the same second.
Yes, because the people usually are doing like that. So this looks like, so if you solve some problem, so you say, okay, this is a strain measure and that's it. Because you see that here, for example, this and that, they're almost the same up to transposition. So it was an original source when we try to understand why we have different results. Up to transpose, and we got different results, said, okay, let us see, because this is probably somebody mistaken, forget this T, or maybe not. What is happens? And we see that in here it defined like this, there it defined like that, because this is, okay, it could be Polish school, Pavel Lużewski is also from Poland, but nevertheless, there are different cases. And Stanovich, for example, he introduced standard Cauchy strain measure as is for classical. It's measure, it's okay, but it results in symmetry of strain stress tensor. And somehow the problem became decoupled. So we can lose coupling between rotations and translations. In general, it's not so nice. It's not so nice when these equations of motion became decoupled. Okay, in this case, very nice problem, but I can solve it independently because from the mathematical point of view, the second equation looks similarly identically up to notations to Lemay equations and linear elasticity. So I can say if I have two for the first equation, I take another two for the second equation and got the solution, everything nice. Only one problem that in this case there will no coupling between rotation. It looks like you solve the same problem for the same body, but no any, let's say, phenomena related to influence of rotations and translations. And when we see some cases like granular material masonries, nevertheless, there is some interactions. And you, if you present a model, there is no interactions. Come on. I see, for example, particles. I put particles, spherical particles on the table and start to rotate them, they start to move. So I see obviously there is a connection between translation and rotation. Why your model does not describe this case? Because your looks like that they rotated independently on translation. Not possible, they don't. Because if I have spherical particles in my mind, connected in some kind of box, and then I try to move these spherical particles, they will rotate, moved, and motion, translation of the particle result will result to its rotation. And this is naive, but looks like true. Okay. Very good. We can now switch to last lab. We are still trying to switch to last lecture. Okay, I'm teach how to use Mac slowly. And now I would like to present, let's say, massive application of tensor calculus to introduce so-called symmetry group in micropolar materials. And okay, so now we consider it generalized model and we consider it symmetry group. And the basic outline is quite simple. And what we try to do. In general, the basic idea for symmetry of which we will consider here relates to description of anisotropic materials. Okay, it will try to explain what is isotropic material, is what is anisotropic material, for example, transversal isotropic material, and so on. Okay, this is a basic idea. And behind this, it is in preparation. Okay, we can say that this is something at least in preparation. Okay, how it looks. The basic idea for material symmetry group of material symmetry in elasticity was introduced by Walter Knoll, and then developed by some people, and they show that standard symmetry group theory results in known results from crystallography. It gives very good tool to define mathematically what is a fluid, for example, what is a solid. Because if I ask my students what is the difference between solids and fluids, its answer is not so easy, because we know that there are a lot of explanations, what is a fluid and what is a solid piece. And here it's, this definition is mathematically precise and so on. It is described like this from the point of view of theory of groups. Okay, we have strain energy. Density which depends on something. Something means what? We have our strain measures, which is most important thing. We have some kind of position of inhomogeneity in space. And we have this B. B describes that initial microstructure, initial microcurvature of our material. This guy is here, it's parametric tensor. Okay, there are some notations which was already introduced. We consider different groups, and the basic idea behind of that is like this. Material symmetry group is such, consists of transformations which keep the energy independent. What this means? I consider two reference placement, because reference placement could be chosen arbitrary in general. You can say that this is my reference placement. Emanuele can say, no, this is mine reference placement for this solid, and so Matteo choose another one. So we have different reference placement taken as an initial point for description of our material. And by the way, sometimes it could be rather useful. For example, in some, for some materials, we can say, okay, this is material has some properties at this temperature and has another property in that temperature. It means that at least the difference between reference states are formulated explicitly in case of this. Okay, in basic idea of this, we consider two reference placements, and we consider transformation from first one into second one. And because the actual configuration is the same, in certain sense, it could happen that our changes of our change of reference placement does not affect the current state. And one example is quite simple. If I have isotropic body, and I have ball made from this isotropic body, and I have second ball, and then I do this for the following trick. I show two balls and say one ball is rotated. Can you discover which ball was rotated? No any experiments give the answer. If you not saw that I rotated this and that, because they are isotropic in sense, any properties are the same. I can rotate it as I want. You cannot distinguish it, measure it, let's say, stiffness and so on. If instead it will be, let's say, made from wood, let's say standard, let's say pine and so on, you see that I rotated because it's, you see this microstructure and this anisotropic, and I say, okay, first time it was stiffness in this direction has this value. Now the stiffness is the same direction, has another value, so probably do something else. You rotate it somehow. So this is a physical explanation between these cases. So I would like to introduce two different reference placements, organize the transformation from one to another one, and see when this transformation does not affect my actual configuration, actual state. Because for example, I observed my actual state, and for example, when I choose one reference placement, sorry for choosing name, it could be another Emanuele, and another Matteo choosing, let's say, another reference placement, it could happen that results depends on this. In this case, I can say that this transformation from first to second placement constitute a symmetry group. Of course, in this case, I should prove that this is a group, otherwise I should call it not group, but something else. But Now it's the basic idea. Okay, and to do this, I am doing this. I make a change of reference placement. This is scheme which I discuss. I have left reference placement, right reference placement with a star, and above I have actual configuration, and I have different mappings. What I have mapping from first to actual, from second to actual, and from the first to second reference placement. Some mappings, and mappings described by gradient of displacement, by its gradient, rotations, and here we introduce also deformation gradient of this mapping and rotations from this to that. Okay. So a lot of tensors and vectors should be considered. Okay, we have strain measures, and to see how our energy strain energy density changes, I should see how it will change our strain measures. Okay, let's start from stretch tensor, this guy. So I consider two deformation gradients defined in different placement. Everything defined to second placement will be with star, with a previous without any star. So I see what is the difference between gradients. And for gradients, it's quite easy to understand that we have that. And similarly, for rotations, we have that formulas. It's just like rigid body, body superposition, but here we have some kind of F star and new tensor, and P is a transformation which is shown here from Z to Z. So if I put everything here, I will get that the E star, it looks like Z. In this case, this is minus I, brings a lot of troubles. But we manage it putting in this. Okay. Now for E star it's quite simple. When we see the next formula, now again, I'm sorry, I'm changing again notation for this Levi-Civita symbol. Now Levi-Civita symbol is this one. This is a Levi-Civita symbol. It's very important tensor having different notations. He changed his shape all the time. It was already thought. Okay. And for gamma, unfortunately, looking at this formula, we should differentiate of this guy. We should find, because what I should do, I should substitute instead of Q, Q star by R here. R, unfortunately, a non-constant, so I should calculate gradient of this and put it to not nice look in a formula and see what this happens. So I do it, I did it. And for this, I am using the representation with, okay, where is was some kind of B introduced and gamma used B, okay. Okay, so let me skip. Let me not boring you with details, so I did it step by step. And this is, by the way, true because we it at least checked twice, at least. So we find the result that it looks like. And what is interesting, E is just changed by multiplications by the of such kind. Here we have not multiplication, but also summation with something else. And this L is another guy which depends on derivative of this R. Here you see derivative of this R results in additional summation with this tensor. Okay. Now I skip this discussion about polar axial vector and tensor. We already know that some of them axial, some of them polar. And so we formulate that Because now, when I change in the reference placement, it could happen that new reference placement is left oriented, because that is not forbidden. Moreover, if I take my students, ask him to write image of coordinate system, I am almost sure that somebody will introduce left-handed, not in this straightforward form, but in the case, for example, I introduce beam, cross-section, and say, okay, there is one axis, or please write x, y. And this is, if you have, let's say, 20 seconds for this, it could be even, let's say, some professors like I am, like me, could manage in left-handed coordinate system. Okay, so here SB and gamma pseudo tensors, because behind of this there is a cross product, this Levi-Civita tensor, you see that it was somewhere, this Levi-Civita tensor, which includes cross product. So we added this determinant of transformation explicitly in this formula. Okay, because we needed to take into account the changes to left hand oriented, to right hand, and vice versa. Okay, now few words about energy. Strain energy is somehow objective. Moreover, if I consider it strain energy of the in actual state, for sure it's something is not does not know as a physical quantity about the choice of reference placement. It's okay, it's clear. So we should find such transformations which does not change the form of energy density. And we will call such transformation invariant ones. Okay, so we considered some invariant transformation. For example, let me say for isotropic solid, as this example with the ball shows that any rotation of the ball is invariant. You can rotate your ball as you want. In the case, if I see the fluid ball, I have a drop of fluid without gravitation, spherical shape, brilliant. But I can not only rotate it, I can also mix it. So it means that not only orthogonal tensor, but I can mix it. I can mix it, make this and so on. And this nobody will discover that I make a mix, put spoon and do this and then say, okay, look, this is a ball. You cannot distinguish. So it means that in the case of fluid, invariant transformations includes not only rotations, but everything which keeps density. Because if you compress it, it's okay, you can measure it, it's already compressed, energy is changed. But if I not compress fluid, I left it as is, fluid or gas, but it's okay. So this means that any unimodular transformation is also included. By unimodular, it means that they keep the volume, determinant of this transformation is equal to 1 or minus 1. Okay, this discussion about energy says that okay, for different any piece of material with in its energy should be conserved. From that point of view, if you consider the changes, here's just integral representation of energy stored in small pieces of our material. So if I consider changes of variable, I came to integral formula from which I take that it looks like that. So energy in one description with a star description looks like energy with this description. So it should be this. As behind of my invariant idea lies the idea that energy should not change its form, it means that I go to this nice formula, for energy, for invariant transformation. So if I have this R, P, R, L, and P is, by the way, taken in the point gradient of displacement from first to second reference configurations. R is a rotation from first to second, and L is somehow constructed tensor related to gradient of R taken in the point. As we know that function and its derivative considered in the point are independent, because to take derivative you should know function in some kind of distance, some vicinity to differentiate. They're independent. So okay, we have that our transformation described by triple of tensors. One of them, let's say tensor general, second rotation tensor, rotation or orthogonal, and third is some tensor. Okay, and now to be formal, I say that there is a definition of material symmetry group. This group consists of ordered, because order is important, groups which consist of three tensors. First belongs to unimodular group because it's responsible to change of the density. Second is orthogonal, and by definition it also unimodular, but it's a rotation. And second tensor is just tensor, second order tensor. And this is should be fulfilled for any domain. It means that for any possible arguments E, gamma, B. Okay. And this is, by the way, important why B appears, because initial micro curvature could be changed with let's say, I have our model with this example, naive example with three beams, and you can consider three beams, like, for example, first case, you can choose it straight, so this micro curvature is zero, but for example, somebody said, okay, but I want to consider it curved, these beams. And so this micro curvature appears. Okay, so this is definition. Of course, this definition is not complete, because to say that something is group, any set of elements is a group, we should introduce the group operation, because it's only in the case we can say that there is a group of students is okay, but in the mathematical sense, we should introduce operations between group, and so it means that two elements of, if you have two elements of the group and we operate with them, produce new element which belongs to the group, there is inverse element and so on, which also belongs to the group and so on. And definition of the group looks like here. And this definition of the group. This circle is just new operation. And we see in first case, what is happens? First is first by second. This is just multiplication. Second by second, just multiplication. But with third element of the group, we have composition of everything. It's not only summation, it's not only multiplication, but some kind of tricky operation, which gives some summation plus multiplication and so on. So nevertheless, this is a group with very non-trivial, I'd like to say, non-trivial group operation. And this group operation includes coupling between all of these elements. And we can check that this is a really group. Simply checking that all elements belong to the group. If two elements belong, then results will belong to the group and so on. This takes some time, but okay, some formulas. You see that a lot of application of tensor calculus here. And inverse element, unit element is this one. Y zero, because first two elements belongs to groups by multiplication. This unim orthogonal groups, they are groups with respect to multiplication, whereas lin is a group with respect to summation. So unit elements looks like 1, 1, 0. So for example, it looks like you have group of numbers, integer, and simple real number. For integer, for example, you can use also multiplication. No, not good example. Okay, or something like that. It's example wrong, because in this case it's also summation. Okay, but for inverse element, we have something also not trivial. For this case, okay, for P, inverse of P is inverse of P. For R, inverse of R, it could be transposed, and transposition is more simple operation. But this is also inverse, whereas for L, inverse is this one. Minus something. And we check this works. And we should do it from the left side, from the right side, because in general we can introduce left inverse element, right inverse element, to be sure that if this is a real inverse element, it could be left and right. Okay, and this definition a bit different from the Erlangen and Kafadar, because they consider it another tensor, they introduce microinertial tensor as a parameter, as a structural tensor. But they also considered three elements of the strain energy, but forget that gamma is a pseudo-tensor. But if you cannot consider it mirror reflection, it's okay, it's the same. We can see the null rule. Null rule is just what is happens with your group if you change them, if you change the reference configuration. So you, the question looks like I have the group defined with respect to one reference placement. I have another group defined from another reference placement. I know the transformation from one to second one. And the question is, can I find the second symmetry group knowing the transformation and knowing the symmetry group of the previous state? And the answer is positive, and answer looks, we make some kind of calculations. I'm afraid that we haven't time to explain what is going here. But finally, we came to nice form that if we have the first group and we have second group, it could be written using this transformation, and this nice P is just element which consists of element of transformation for one placement to another placement. This is null rules, which looks non-trivial. Classical null rules looks like that. Here we have the first group, and here we have simple dot product instead of this circle. Here we have something more complex. And if you consider some application, you can consider a trivial group. And trivial group consists two elements, one and minus one. Okay, most trivial group consists one element, but unit, but this is gives no any results. But if you consider it, let's say, this minimal group, then we see that we get such kind of formulas, which already something should be, for example, it cannot be linear terms with respect to gamma if you restrict ourselves by true scalars. Okay, so for example, it couldn't be considered such guy. It could be a relative invariant of these two tensors, but not absolute invariant. Okay, second case, we can see that, okay, let us say that this RL is arbitrary, any tensor. In this case, I can do the following. I can put it here, see that in this case, for example, I should have such property. And then I can prove that it is a, instead of three arguments, E gamma B, B structural tensor, I get dependence on two, this one, because there is some kind of invariance. And it's somehow related, it's probably one of that say could be also interpreted via Noether's theorem, but in simplest probably form, some invariance with respect to some transformations. And okay, now I consider it as particular. I forget about dependence on B. I see this only. In this case, if I repeat the formulations for a previous case for any arbitrary L, I will get very nice continuum which depends only on one strain measures, which is still non-symmetric. And this so-called reduced Cassera continuum, which results in very interesting forms, let's say, of equilibrium equations. You see that this equation, for example, in this form, Eulerian form, it looks like skew symmetric. This is something related to skew symmetric part of stress tensor is determined by applied moments. And there is some people who consider such a model for description of some cases of granular model, granular medias. And finally, if we assumed additionally that R is any arbitrary rotational tensor, we can come for this case to standard Cauchy material because everything will be transformed to dependence to this tensor, which is a classical tensor of applied to which is used in polar decomposition of the standard deformation gradient. U squared gives us Cauchy-Green strain measure. So in his case, automatically Cauchy stress tensor becomes symmetric, moment stress tensor is zero, and so on. So in this case, it's okay, so we see that some kind of reduction of elements could be done, and we consider it some kind of isotropy. Isotropy looks like what? It should be rotations only or mirror reflections. And we forget about third components, it should be zero. In this case, it's just our explanation, macropolar material is isotropic if we cannot distinguish any rotations. So in this case, energy density will be isotropic function, and we can use theory thin variants to get it. Fluid, and fluid is defined in this case very simple because it means that we should consider all elements of possible groups. So all unimodular group, all orthogonal or linear. In this case, we came to conclusion that in this case, our symmetry group is independent of reference placement. And this is, by the way, is obvious. If your group is maximum, group, okay, maximum group is maximum group, it does not depend on anything. Because how you can distinguish, for example, it includes all of elements. So you cannot distinguish why it relates to this or that reference placement. It's a maximum group. And this is relates to fluid, and we can find the constitutive equation for fluid, and we do it, and we continue to do it. And what is interesting, became dependent on determinant of F and additional C. C was introduced before, and this is an actual curvature tensor. If I again remind you this example with these beams, so we consider it microstructure as bending of these, let's say, imaginary beams, somehow okay, related to these beams. So it should replace what is going on with this structure related to this curvature of this. So let me say a few words. C somehow includes curvature of these beams and actual placement and torsion of these beams from the point of view differential geometry. Okay, and so we came to these nice formulas. C is independent to reference placement, determinant of F is thus also an independent. Moreover, this function should be isotropic. This is an isotropic function or chemitropic function with respect to C. And so we can find its representation from this theory invariance. And here we see that it depends on 7 invariants of such kind, because just repetition of the theory invariants. 7 guy could be somehow excluded by functional dependence. So it looks like that. So it's given in this very particular form. A lot of components, nevertheless, it is. And typical example like quadratic form, we have the classical for compressible fluid and non-classical terms related to microstructure of this fluid. And the equation in this case looks like that. So tensor of stresses looks like spherical part plus something, and this something relates to moments. And moments are dependent on this structural tensor, like typical dependence, isotropic dependence. And another model was proposed by some people. You see some references shown here. And so on. So it also, so there is some relations to liquid crystals by Erikson. And so for solids, we assume that rotations, micro rotations and macro rotations are the truth kind side. We introduce what is a solid body. Solid body is based on very reduced material symmetry group, which consists only in rotations and rotations of orthogonal tensors belonging to subgroup of orthogonal group. And what is interesting, in this triple, this element must coincide. In this case, we came to the case of solids, fluids defined, solids defined, unfortunately or fortunately, it depends on point of view. From my point of view, it's so nice, we have something in between. And this is called, I prefer to use it word subfluids, because liquid crystals could be treated as the Erikson-Leslie liquid crystal models. And by subfluid, we mean something which group contains non-orthogonal elements, but not fluid. And it was one guy, Wang, who introduced this group subfluids for standard materials, Cauchy continuum. And some of them could look like description of crystal materials when you have, let's say, you have possibility to slip crystalline plane according to some planes. So they look like fluid in one direction. You can easily move it in one direction, but you cannot move in another direction. And this let's say, looks like some kind of point of view on a so-called crystal plasticity, and so on. There is also kind of, let's say, reduced Cassara continuum proposed by Greco Vasilin and developed by Grekova in further papers. They considered some kind of invariance with respect to chosen a priori chosen vector. And from that point of view, this is a subfluid, macropolar subfluid, because the invariant under rotations with respect to only one vector and so on. And this is some kind of, this is C.C. Wang who wrote very particular paper about subfluids and see some kind of dilatation group looks like that. P double dot that P should be as P is unimodular by definition and group contains such elements. And of course, any product of such elements result in the same element. And just P1, P2, P3 shouldn't be, let's say, seen zeros. And that we have such kind of elements. And these planes, 1, 2, 3, for this you can make some kind of stretching and so on. And we introduced isotropic material, so group should be orthogonal. It just all rotations, mirror reflections included. Then let me remind there is application of theory of invariance, because in this case we can apply it again theory of invariance and formulate system of invariance are presented here. They were developed by Kafadar and Eringen 50 years ago. Okay, and keeping in mind that this gamma is pseudo vectors, this function should have some kind of additional properties. We can construct some quadratic or approximate polynomial representations given here, for example, and do this in, for example, in more particular cases, it could be even less invariance if our energy is just split in two forms, into two functions independently dependent on strain measures. We haven't joined invariance, it makes our life better. And Ramizani made some finite element calculations for finite deformations of such kind of material. And okay, we can do this stuff for other, let's say, group. We introduce, let's say, chemitropic group, orthotropic materials group, which consists of a very particular case of symmetry group, cubic symmetry group, which is quite difficult to find a representation of the material equations for such kind of group, and transversal isotropic material here, and for some materials like which energy takes quadratic form with some stiffness coefficients, here we have instead of 1C we have additional coupling tensor first order, and let's say another stiffness tensor related to bending and torsion. And we have some symmetries which is just following from existence of energy for that kind. This is so-called physically linear model, because despite the tensors are non-linearly dependent on displacement and rotation, the stresses, some stresses, depends linearly on strain measures. And for her, speaking about this CB in D tensors, we can see what happens with for some groups, and for example, if the group is contains minus one, this coupling should be zero if we treat B as a true tensor which contains only true scalars. And okay, let me remind you that we introduce Foyk notations for linear elasticity. Here, unfortunately, C is not symmetric with respect to these in first two and second two indices. So it led 9 by 9 matrix. Okay, come on, we have 9 by 9 matrix is written here. And the same you can do for other matrices. So let us discuss one matrix. Otherwise, we have a lot of slides for three. Okay. And one so-called monoclinic symmetry, it contains some, let's say, refraction, reflection with some kind of planes. This already kills a lot of elements. Here we have how many elements? We have in general, we have 9 by 9, 81 element for each tensor. Okay. Here we have 50 elements. Here for autotropic symmetry, you see that matrix became more and more simple. There are a lot of zeros. And if you assume these rotations in additional, you have this matrix. And for isotropic case, we got this. So we have 6 independent elastic moduli. It's still enough. Instead of 2, we have 6. And this is the isotropic tensors of fourth order, which we met before. 2 isotropic tensors of fourth order, and this is already well defined. And this is, let's say, some introduction of these coefficients according to Ehringen, Novatsky, and so on. And for hemitropic materials, if we considered materials without any symmetry to mirror reflection, it should be also B with additional parameters, additional 3. So for hemitropic materials, we have 9 parameters, and this was discussed by Kishlevich in his book. And if it remind me that there is a B, like microstructural tensor, which we have, and if we add this B here, it becomes very complicated formulas, because if you can say that it's linearly dependent on E, it's okay, linearly dependent on gamma, okay, but B is just a structural tensor, so we have a lot of parameters related invariants of B and joint invariants, and so it could be quite complicated task. And finally, we succeeded to finish. I thank you all for your patience, attention in being here. So I'm not sure that you have so tired and bored that you haven't questions, but okay, I'm asking you for a question. If not, I wish you all the best in this hot topic. Now the weather is not so hot, but we improve the weather by considering hot science. Okay, questions, comments? Okay, no questions, no comments.
I would like to make comments, so I'd like to thank you very much, Victor, for this very nice presentation, for taking the care of preparing all these slides. I remember that these lectures have been recorded, and we will be shortly available on the remote site to everyone.
Okay, Antonio, thank you so much. You are really kind, because of course this presentations could be better and presentations could be also better, everything, but nobody is perfect. Okay, thank you so much and see you next time probably. Okay.